You can start in next 10 seconds.
Okay. Good evening, Jai Gurudev. I am Ravi Rao, Head of Department for Central Training and Placement Cell at CC University. I warmly welcome all of my viewers for this informative and amazing session today. MBA is a very popular program for the young generation. Every student after their graduation wanted to look at MBA program as a part of their next postgraduate qualifications. There's a lot of unclarity involved. There's a lot of unclarity regarding the different disciplines. There's unclarity about what importance the different disciplines holds when the students join the corporates after the degree when he holds it. We are going to talk about the different specializations starting from today. The specialization which we are going to talk about today is the backbone of any industry. If this doesn't work, nothing works for. This is the specialization where a lot of strategic analytical skills are required. But obviously the people who are teaching this and the people who are working in this domain are exceptionally outstanding. I have an excellent panel members with us. We have Dr. Alok Kumar Sahai. Dr. Sahai works as an associate professor with Sri Sri University. Dr. Sahai holds an M.Tech from IIT Roorkee and a PGDM from IIM Bangalore. He obtained his PhD from National Law University in Behavioral Finance. He teaches project finance and asset valuation at Sri Sri University. Dr. Sahai has extensive corporate experience in general management and has 11 years of experience teaching MBA students in three different universities. Dr. Sahai has over 20 years of trading in stock and future market and teaches technical courses in post-grad diploma in financial management programs run in collaboration with National Stock Exchange. He brings his considerable corporate and academic experience to the classroom. Dr. Sahai, I welcome you to the session, sir.
Unmute yourself, sir, please.
Thank you, Ravi. Thank you for this nice introduction. Thank you.
I have another expert in panel, Dr. Vishal Sood. Dr. Vishal Sood is working as professor with Sri Sri University. Dr. Vishal Sood is a PhD in finance and his expertise in derivative and investment management. He has more than 20 years of teaching experience in private and government institutions across India. He possesses more than 12 years of experience in the field of operations, consulting, and research based on collateral management, warehousing development, and commodity markets of Africa and India. In the field of research, he has 60 in publication, national and international journals. He had authored a book on security analysis and portfolio management and claimed two best paper awards. He's also associated as an expert consultant to develop warehousing and collateral management in India with certain of commodity market development in the global SMEs chamber Indore. I warmly welcome you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Coming to our next panel members, I really feeling privileged of it because when you introduce our own students who got graduated from Sri Sri universities and working with the reputed corporates, you really feel very proud of introducing them. My third panel member is Mr. Meet Amlani. Mr. Meet is from 2017-19 MBA batch and is working with PwC as Senior Associate Valuation. Mr. Meet.
Well, thank you, sir. Thank you for bringing me up to the panel for this valuable discussion. I'm glad to be here.
I have another panel member, Ms. Shruti Agarwal. Shruti Agarwal is from 2017-19 MBA batch. She's working with KPMG Global Services as US Tax Associate. Shruti, I welcome you to the session.
Thank you, sir. I feel great to be here. Thank you.
Great, we go to the further sessions right now. As the topic was already been described, its importance of finance specializations and its employment opportunities with corporates. My first question to Dr. Sahai. Dr. Sahai, how how much importance the MBA specialization holds in an MBA program and how our pedagogy at SSU in training finance students are different.
Okay, that's a very good question. It's also a very long question. I will just begin with the importance of the finance. See, finance importance cannot be overemphasized. This is the core of the business. If you have no money, there is no business. So this forms the core foundation of any business. Now, when we talk about the finance, there are three things which come to our mind. The first thing is sourcing of the funds. How do you source the funds? You can source the fund from your own pocket, in which case it will be your own equity. You can source the funds from your dad. That will be a loan. You can source the fund from a bank loan. That will be again a loan. So that is like a debt and equity. Or you can go to the public and take money from them. So that is the first thing, sourcing of the funds. Second is you have to think, okay, now I have got the funds. How do I utilize it? So the users of the funds, where do you put the money? So because money has to return the money, you are borrowing the money, you have to return with the interest. So you need to find the best avenues. So to get the best avenues, you need to find the assets. Where do you put? So what kind of plant, what kind of machinery, where do you put the money? So that is another decision. The third decision which comes into the finance is the, the capital budgeting. You are having different projects and you have to choose which is the best one. So each one is having a cost benefit ratio. Each one is having a different payback ratio. There are different tools which you use to find out the best possible opportunities depending on the business environment. So that would be the thing. So I can give you an example from Jio. Jio is, why I'm telling about Jio, because Jio has touched our lives in some way or another. More than half the people in India are connected with Reliance Jio. We are using Jio services. When Jio started working, they built the structure, they built the infrastructure, they put everything. And at one time, like in 2019, they had a loan book of 1.5 lakh crore rupees. That is huge. So they had done everything with the loans. And now, as you know, now the business is working. So for about 1 year, for close to 6 to 9 months, they were doing everything free. Means all the operational expenses they were taking. That is the burn rate. So when you are deciding about a massive enterprise like Reliance Jio rollout, you have to think how much money is needed, how much money is needed to sustain till we see the first rupee. So they were in the red for about 6 to 9 months. Then they came into black after the first year. And now they are profitable. So everyone knows how Reliance has actually sold some chunks of their business, the Jio business. They have already collected around 60,000 crore rupees. And today their valuation stands at around 5 billion rupees, 5.5 billion rupees. So that is how you start a business. That is how the funds were arranged. And that is how it has gone. Coming to the second part of your question, how SSU pedagogy is different, how it helps the students. I would say that in SSU, there are three prong attack. The first thing is that we go through case studies. So it is not just learning by rote. We also take the case studies from Harvard and we have discussions in the class. So the students get to know how these things, the nuts and bolts of the things that we have learned, how it is being applied. So that they see the applied part. The second thing that we are unique in is we are having a very vast network and using that, we bring in all kinds of experts. So experts are coming these days. It is technology. So experts are also coming online. Sometimes they are also coming, in person. So they are coming to our campus in person. They are interacting with the students. And sometimes we also bring the prospective employers, because they come and tell that these are the required skills, whether you are having the skills or not. These are the things that we are looking at. So we are always in touch with the industry and we are updating our courses. So that is the second thing. And the third thing, which I would say, which is very important, which in some places it is lacking, that is capstone project. So in the final semester, we are giving a capstone project, which is a full-fledged, 4-unit course. So which is done under the mentorship of one faculty. So it's like, a one-to-one relationship is there with the faculty and they actually learn. They take a capstone project of their choice. It will be in the same field, like if they're finance, they will take a finance thing. And then they work on that. So that is where they, it is like owning the skills that they have learned in the 3 semester, in the 4 semester. And then from there, they are just ready to be launched. So it's like a football. So they are prepared with the capstone. So these are the three things which I would say, these are the highlights of our program, which prepare the students to be corporate ready. That is, what I think is the most unique thing about our program.
Dr. Sahai, thank you very much for such a detailed analysis of it. So what I understand from the conversation which we had is the first thing, which is where we are different, is the case base. Second is the interaction with the prospective recruiters. And third is the caption project. That's what the
caption project. Caption project, yes, that is the thing.
Excellent, excellent. Sir, thank you very much. The question shifts to Dr. Vishal Sood. Vishal Sood, sir, you have such extensive experience working with corporates and universities and teaching MBA finance students. What is your perspective, sir? What is our pedagogy which is different from any other institution, university, where they teach MBA finance students?
Well, major things are being covered by Dr. Sahai, but few more add-ons which I would like to make today are like MBA itself as a course is a very sought after course. Means it is student's delight. You cannot deny the fact that MBA finance rather is a type of course that is leading upfront. Leading upfront means it is so lucrative that students find a way to manage his own fund as well as others' funds also. Now, considering the fact that Indian economy is under severe pressure, it has to perform, it has to prove its worth. And that is only possible when our finance team or our team of experts can come up with an idea whereby they can innovate, they can generate, they can create revenues and surplus for rather industries, for corporates, for new businesses. And this is only possible when the fresh blood can come in the market and dictate terms. Here at SSU, what we used to do is we used to provide a holistic development, a 360 degree development to our students. Under the flagship of Pujya Gurudev, visionary president Rajita Madam, Vice Chancellor Sir Dr. Ajay Kumar Ji, headship of Subharao Sir in FCMS, and the eminent team. What we used to do is we used to tailor-made or we used to design such a syllabi which is more like industry-driven. We used to call people from industry and take inputs from them. That inputs are incorporated in our syllabus. And once these are incorporated, what we used to do is we used to train our students, we used to teach our students in a way that they are future ready. More of our programs, more of our studies, more of our trainings are based on future readiness. We think that if we give our students a live project, a base, a platform from where they can, you can say, get start, get set, go, then they can learn or they can come up with new ideas. And finance as a field is a very dynamic field. When we talk about finance, the demand for finance is never ending. It is, you can say, as Sir said, it's a blood. It's a lifeblood for any industry. It is required on day-to-day basis. Without finance, you cannot even dream of a company to run successfully. And to manage this finance is the most vital thing. We at SSU, what we used to do is we used to teach our students how to be future ready, how to cater those challenges which are being posed in the market due to such type of inconsistencies. Inconsistencies create challenges and they are case in itself. So by using case studies, by using capstone projects, by using all these advanced pedagogies, by inviting delegates on the university platform to share their expertise, their knowledge, their skills with our students. We make our students, you can say, so competitive that they are ready to conquer, they are ready to cater any segment of market, and they are in a position to dictate terms. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vishal. So it was really a great assessment what you shared with us. So as far as my understanding is concerned, sir, you are talking about in SSU, our pedagogy is circled towards developing individuals holistically. And the second thing which we mentioned is our pedagogy and curriculum keeps on changing based on the marketing terms. Is that what you're referring to, sir, as a point of additions?
Yes, sir.
Okay. That's outstanding. We are coming to the third panel member. So Mr. Meet, you're working with PwC right now as a senior associate evaluation. The pedagogy you have been trained for in finance in SSU helped you to get this desired job? And is it helping you to grow professionally right now?
Yeah, yes, sir, definitely. I was just trying to recollect those days when Alok sir just mentioned about the Capstone project. You know, my interview at PwC India AC was much, a lot of the questions were based on the Capstone project, which I did. I did a valuations project as a part of my Capstone project, and I entered the valuations field. So that particular project helped me a lot. And so that is one of the pedagogies, right? The interactions with which I had with the industry experts for those for that particular project, again, helped me a lot to, you know, face for the interview. You know, there's a certain type of anxiety when you there's nervousness, but probably I did not have any of them since I had some prior experience, which SSU had given to me in the past. And the first one, the case studies. So when you actually work on the case studies, you get a hands-on experience of the terminologies of the market or of the industry, or probably the problems, right? The case studies are the problems which we have to solve at our end, thinking of like, if I was in a situation like this, which has occurred in the past, in the history, how would I be solving it or trying my mind out towards it, right? So yes, that helped me a lot. One thing which I'd like to point out here is at Sri Sri University, you know, the case studies which are given to the students to solve, they are not like decades old. I remember in one of our lectures in 2019, you know, Sandeep sir had got me a Harvard Business Review case, which was like just 3 months old. Now, a 3 month old case study is highly difficult to get, right? So like whatever is actually going on in the market, as Vishal Sood sir just mentioned that, you know, we change our curriculum as per the market. If today we are running more on the insolvency and bankruptcy projects or the forensics, we see a lot of scams happening nowadays in the world, right? Not just in India, in the world. And in 2016 or 17, 16, I believe, the Arun Jaitley government or the finance under him got this IBC, insolvency and bankruptcy code introduced for, you know, solving the bankruptcy projects or probably the scams. So we introduce those types of case studies into our curriculum, and that helps us a lot, you know, to face the cutthroat competition which is going on in the market. So yes, the pedagogy which Alok sir and Vishal sir mentioned is like bang on, and like all the words come out to be true. Yeah, it definitely helps me right now in my curriculum. Sorry, not in the curriculum, it at my job right now at PwC India AC.
Perfect, Meet. I'm really happy to see that the pedagogy which we normally carry here is definitely going to add value to the individuals when they're working. So you highlighted something like case study, which helped you a lot You highlighted the CAFTU project, which you normally do at SSU, normally helps students to get a job and grow professionally. I think that's a wonderful point to be made. Thank you.
One more thing, which when Alok sir was mentioning the three things, the case studies, the interaction with industry experts, and the CAFTU project. So if Alok sir has also taught me a lot of parts of the valuation. If you rightly remember, it's like a football field. Remember, that's when we get all the three methods of valuation put up together on a football field. We chart them up and then come out with the solution. So, like at the final solution. So this is like the same thing, you know. This pedagogy acts like a football field, at least in the finance terminologies or in the finance world for me. So yeah, that I could relate to it, and then I felt nostalgic.
Excellent, Kevin. Thank you, Meet, for sharing this. My next question to Shruti. Shruti, you're working with KPMG right now. How the pedagogy at SSU actually helped you to get the campus placement in KPMG, and how are you doing professionally by using all those which you have learned at the SSU campus?
Yes, sir. So there's a lot to share that truly helped me to land up in this job. So I remember the day when we had this pre-placement talk of KPMG, where the interviewers mentioned that they are looking for two things in the participants that are first, their basic concepts should be very clear, and the second, they are looking for an attitude which is ready to learn at each stage of their journey, and a learning attitude. So there I was very thankful to the set of faculties that we have at SSU, which are constantly encouraging us to know our concepts rightly. They are focused on teaching us conceptual based and practical based learning, and that helped me go through the interview as well. And also I think that not only the domain knowledge is enough, we should know how to present ourselves in front of the recruitment process, and there is where I think the training and placement cell helped a lot. They played a very good role there, because we had so many of mock sessions every day, and the mock sessions for interview as well as for the aptitude test which we are going to face. So that somewhere helped before giving that final shot. So yeah, that really helped. And one more thing which I liked most about SSU or SSU faculties and the placement department is that they are not limited only to the people getting their jobs. Even after I got my job, I was very well trained that how you can grow in your career, how you can grow in your professional career, and what are the things you should follow. What are the things you should follow and what are the things you should not at the starting stage of your professional career, which as a fresher was very much required for me. And that is even helping me now to grow in my professional career. So yeah, we had so many of industry exposure at SSU, which is really helping right now. And Meet and Alok sir, all of you mentioned that we had capstone projects, case study method of learning. That really helps. I would like to mention that during my capstone project, I had my mentor as Vinod Gopal Mukherjee sir, and there he was very much ready, every time ready to guide me how to take up a project that will be very much required for the today's industry, and how to go about that project. And then it is evaluated by a set of experts when we come back to SSU, and they share their experience with us, which takes as a long way ahead. Thank you.
Shruti, thank you very much for sharing this. You rightly mentioned it is the point I think which you highlighted was we have a right integration of conducting the training for a domain knowledge and employability skill. That is the reason why most of the people, most of the students from SSU get employed after the course. So thank you, Shruti. Thank you very much for sharing that. My next question goes to Dr. Sahai. So Dr. Sahai, you know, the world is changing right now. The market dynamics are changing. There's a huge transformations are coming up with, you know, we have seen this with COVID-19 situation, the entire working structure of the corporate got changed. So how do you see, what is the future of finance right now? How we are, where exactly we are heading to?
Okay, Ravi sir, I think I'm sure everyone here, you know, knows something about fintech. Every day we are hearing that, you know, fintech is coming, but most of the people, you know, they don't have an understanding of fintech. So fintech is the future of finance. You know, this year we are going to include some papers in our curriculum. And probably maybe in 2021 onwards, we are going to offer MBA FinTech. It will be no longer MBA Finance, but we will just change it to MBA FinTech because that is what the industry demands. Now, to tell you briefly what FinTech is, where the finance is going, you know, going from Bitcoin, everyone knows, the digital currency, the cryptocurrency. But actually, FinTech is something which touches our lives. You know, again, once again, I'll say that FinTech is touching our lives every day. One out of three or two out of three, you know, between somewhere like 30 to 40% people are touched by FinTech almost every day. You know, when you use a mobile to use to do a digital transaction, that is FinTech behind it. And what has happened, you know, the banking is the largest thing. Banking is, you know, is something which goes into trillions of dollars globally, the global banking business. The transactions, the online transaction processing, the OLTP, you know, these are the things which are actually backed by the technology. So previously, what was happening, the technology was always in the background. Like technology is there, all the big banks, you know, India, the computerization happened much later. The CBS, you know, the core banking, it happened much later. But previously, it was always there, you know, the SWIFT code, those who have used the SWIFT code to transfer the money, the wire transfer, all those things, the international transfer of money. It was all happening through the, computers. So there was a lot of technology involved there. Then the technology has come from background to the foreground. Now it has come between the companies and the customers. I'll just give you an example, you know, how the FinTech is being used by the company. There are many startups in FinTech, and you know, FinTech is where, you know, a lot of technical knowledge along with the finance knowledge is going. So I was reading a case recently. I'm preparing the syllabus for that. So I saw that, suppose, you know, you are having a poor credit score, your credit score is bad, so you go to a conventional bank, the bank says, sorry, I cannot give you loan. So there are algorithm, what they do, they take your mobile phone, they take your mobile transactions, all the mobile transactions that you have done. So they do the data mining into your mobile transactions, and then they say, okay, you are having a credit score of this much. So there are companies which are willing to give you a loan. You know, these are not the banks, the conventional banks, as we know, SBI, Patiala Bank, or, you know, Punjab National Bank. These are other banks. These are microfinance lenders who will come to you and they will say, okay, your transaction we have seen, your mobile transactions we have seen, and we are willing to give you loans. So that is the future of finance. You know, the finance, it is going to be a lot of technology based things. And like I said, you know, I would say that most of the jobs will be coming into the world of technical thing, the FinTech. The FinTech is the place to go. So I see finance, most of the finance courses slowly merging into the FinTech course. The conventional finance will always be there, like, you know, the Manac 1, Manac 2, corporate finance will be there. But the applied part, the application of this will go there. You know, I have seen many, my meet here is an engineer. So many of the engineers, they are drawn towards finance automatically because, you know, that is how they find it much easier to work on models. So work on models, the complex algorithms. So this is like the structured finance and all those things. The high-end finance is going to be FinTech only. That is the future of finance. So we at SSU are already geared up to meet the challenges of future. So probably next year we'll be launching it. And we are already adding some courses this year onwards.
That is excellent. So you said the future of the finance is going to be FinTech, and we are super ready to train our students on the FinTech subject. So yes, I think that's a good idea. It is going to create the probability of more selections in the corporates, I'm sure.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much for sharing, sir. Dr. Vishal, so I have a very important question for you, sir, with the kind of experience you have. How MBA Finance prepares students to face the financial crisis, which normally appear during intervals?
Thank you, sir. Thank you for asking this question. When it comes to crisis, it's not so okay crises are not occurring earlier on. But the only thing is, the big difference is the readily available information regarding crisis. Earlier, we were aloof of what crises are all about, how crises are going to affect our lives. But now, due to advent of information system, availability of information, then it has played a bigger role in, you can say, snowballing the crisis. We are not saying we should underestimate the crisis. Crises are there, but we should have, or we should be rather in a position to take a strategic decision how to overcome these crises. After LPG, in the year 2000 or something like 2001 or 2, when India was forced to accept, you can say, IT as well as LPG, there, since then onwards, it was on cards that the potency of crisis will increase by time. We have observed huge crises like Ketan Parekh scam in stock market, then Black Swan. Then we have studied about subprime crisis, COVID. Its effect will be evaluated or seen later on in the days to come rather. But the most important thing is to get ourselves prepared from these particular crises. These crises provides you a base to understand where the gap and vacuum lies in our system. If our system is transparent enough, if our system is good enough to explain how economy is moving, how finance or funds are being managed, we might be in a position to cut down these crises. This is just because the lack of awareness regarding financial terminologies, regarding financial issues, are more in the market. The education system should be designed in a way that all these crises should be taken care of and used as a case to teach students. We should focus on teaching our student or equipping our student by preparing case studies, by making them so aware, or trying to bring them on a platform where they can involve themselves into role playing, so that we can have a better idea, we can have a broader vision to encounter future crises. If at all there might be more crises in future, we may be in a position to take a strategic action whereby using funds, using base value of funds, or using using efficiency of managing funds and the resources, we can come up as a better country. We can foresee future more efficiently, and we prepare ourselves, or we hedge ourselves in a way that these crises may not affect our economy. The best example which I would like to quote in this case is subprime crisis. When this subprime bubble burst, almost America, Japan, China, all these third world countries were directly or indirectly affected. But in India, its effect was very late. That is because our financial system was so well designed that we were able to sustain that particular shock. So considering all these things, if we teach our students all these intricacies of finance and we guide them in a way that they develop the neck of finance right from the bottom level, it will take them, it will make them, it will imbibe in them all those skills, like analytical skill, reasoning skills, which they can help, which may be helpful to make strategic decision every now and then. And this decision, this knowledge will certainly help companies, economies, and government to sustain for a longer period of time. So it assists you. What we used to do is we used to equip them with all these things. We try to focus on blended learning. Rather than we are focusing on single aspect, we try to come up with blended learning whereby we even provoke our students to compete with other students, other universities, where the different mindsets get churned. And this creates a better technical know-how, a better human skill within the students. And by this, students learn, grow, and prepare themselves for future challenges. Thank you.
Dr. Shudam, thank you very much for sharing. I really understand and acknowledge what you said, sir. It is not a conventional, a traditional level of education we are imparting to the students. We are doing a blended learning, the right word you used, sir. And with this learning, definitely the students are going to come up with their best of their ability and start performing well. Thank you very much for sharing, Dr. Vishal Sood.
Thank you, sir.
Next question goes to Mr. Meet. Mr. Meet, as you're part of such a reputed firm, working as a very very important decision-making position. So I just wanted to understand, the student who wanted to take finance right now, do you have any suggestions for them? Or somebody who are coming from a different background, for example, if somebody has done BCom, is it the only MBA finance has been made for him? Or somebody is coming for humanities, can they understand MBA finance? So what is your suggestion for the people who say that finance is very difficult, we cannot take it up? And you came from an engineering background and you took up the finance. I understand the linkage because you understand the numericals more. But the person is coming from the background where there is no such kind of numericals involved. If he wanted to pursue the finance, can he look at it? What is your input for this?
That's actually a great question. And I think I somehow knew that you would be asking me this in the morning. So yes, I come from the engineering side, and one of the major person who provoked me in taking up this course was Dr. Vijaya Bhatt. Probably you don't know her. She was a professor before you joined, and she was a finance faculty. She was a great, great person. So you know, when I took up MBA, I always had this inclination towards finance, because after I left my previous organization, Emerson, you know, Emerson Network Power was being separated from the family Emerson Electric, and that's when I asked my mentors at Emerson Network Power that, you know, how do they decide on the price? And what makes them separate themselves, or what does Emerson Electric make them lose that particular asset? You know, I just wanted to know that, because they were from IIMs and they were at a higher position than me, and they could have explained it to me better. They just told me one thing. You know what, Meet? When you're taking, you're going for the MBA course, right? You know, you learn it when you take finance. And that's when actually provoked me to take up finance as a major, because, you know, when I was coming here, you know, everyone thought like I will take up marketing, because people think that, you know, I can sell, I can market products well. Sorry. So and that's when Vijaya ma'am, you know, said that if the world thinks, if the world is saying, I'm not saying, okay, that I'm good at marketing, I've never tried that one, you know. So if Vijaya ma'am said that, you know, Meet, if you if people think that you're good at marketing and if you believe them, you know, why do you want to probably continue the same? Why not take something new and make it as the best thing which can be, you know, your future? And that really helped me, because finance is something which I'm inclined to since a long time now. As you said, you know, I love number crunching. I was into equities, stock trading and all that. You know, I've spent days and hours together with Alok sir on this particular topic. So it's not really difficult, you know, as your question was like, is it the only condition or on an option for a commerce students, or if a humanities person can come up here, or an engineer can come up? You know, this is rightly addressed by Alok sir's answer to your question about the fintech stuff. You know, as an engineer, if I am taking finance, you know, I can help drive the future of finance industry, that is the fintech. You know, right now, if you have read some news articles from, I guess, September last year, Deloitte and PwC are putting together, I mean, like separately, of course, around $3.5 billion into automizing stuff, you know, into technology driven finance industry. You know, they are a professional services firm which give a lot of services in the market, and they want their business to drive technologically. If you can recollect, you know, when the computer, when the first computer was introduced in this world, it was a room size, and it was, their hard drive was just 64 MB. But, you know, the technology has driven it so far that, you know, today we have 256 GB in my phone. But so you understand, right, how fast the world is changing. And if it is not technological driven, you know, probably you'll be left behind. So it's not necessary that, you know, no one can learn up. You know, I never, a child is not born learning how to walk, right? You know, you put your leg outside in the world and you start walking. It's just that if you think it's a myth, or, you know, if it's an option available, if I can do it, it's just lacking confidence, maybe. You know, you can definitely do well when you just step out of the world, and then you'll be driven pretty well. I'd like to, you know, also take one thing from what Dr. Vishal Sood said here. You know, how are we ready for it, or how our curriculum is making the students prepare for the future world, or the scamiest world, or the crisis world? When he was talking about this thing, you know, he mentioned about that super scam. The crisis which he faced, or he has lived in the past. You know, right now, when we were in the COVID world, now, how do you understand how to deal with the situation? Now, I am a fresher, you know, until the people who, the most recent scam, the major scam which we look into the finance world, is from the 2008 Lehman Brothers crisis, right, in the US market. Now, people who have passed after 2010, until last one decade, you know, they know nothing of crisis. You can actually say this, right? Now, where do you learn how to deal with the crisis? It's from the experiences of such nice professors at Sri Sri University, or anywhere. You know, Vishal Sood sir has lived in the past in that crisis situation, has faced it and come out of it. Alok sir was also doing the same. Mukherjee sir has worked in a stock exchange company in Mumbai since 33 years now. He has such great experience. You just, you know, squeeze that experience out of them, and then, you know, prepare yourself. Because I, as a fresher, when I go in this COVID world situation, I'm like, oh, okay, how to deal with this? I have no experience, right? But you can learn from them. How many, you know, the most senior person to you is like, you know, the 10-year-old person who has come out from an MBA course, or an engineer in the industry. But these guys who have more experience, you know, you have to learn from them. And that's what I did at Sri Sri University. You know, Alok sir was always available at 5 in the morning. I've had almost, and out of 2 years, we've had breakfast together at 7 in the morning. Somnath Tata sir, we speak at 2 in the night. So to understand all these stuff, you know, if the professors are really available, why not make use of it? So, yeah, this is what I have, this is what have made me prepare to face this crisis situation. And it's definitely, I'll not say it's a piece of cake, but you can definitely bake the cake if you have the training and the exposure from the right professors to, you know, enter the finance world, even if you're from an engineering background or a humanities background or a commerce background or maybe from a non-finance background. It's definitely, you can definitely bake the cake, I'm saying.
Amit, thank you very much for sharing this. These are really very significant pointers which you have mentioned. I'm sure this is going to give a lot of clarity to the new aspirants who really wanted to pursue finance specialization as a part of their MBA program. Thank you very much, Amit. Thank you very much.
Sure, thanks.
Now, my next question goes to Shruti Agarwal. Shruti, when MBA students start studying, they normally do general management in first year. And after that, there's a time comes when you have to choose the specialization. My question to you is, you have to choose specialization based on the undergraduate specialization which you have, or you have to decide it after the first year of general management?
Yes, sir. I think it's a very relevant question for the coming up aspirants. So I don't think that it depends on the undergrad course that you had before coming up to this MBA course. Like we have example as Meet. He was from BTech background, then he pursued finance, and now he is doing so well in his professional career. So it not always depends on the background that you have, but I think it depends more on the your own personal interest, rather, I would say. So I took up finance because of my own strong personal interest in finance. And like when you enter into finance MBA specialization, you got to know that there are many subjects that are covered in the finance specialization, like wealth management, taxation, and project management, or say it be a corporate valuation. So everything you see that this each subject is itself like a whole specialization now. It depends on your own interest in which you want to make a career in. And Meet rightly pointed out that no one is a learner by birth. When you get into finance MBA specialization, there you know how to get this knowledge and how you can take up more decisions regarding to financial management. And you know how to take up decisions, how to manage well between risk and profitability. Because now every industry requires a good financial expert who can manage their capital very well. And you mentioned that finance is the backbone of every industry. So the scope is enormous, I think. And the student has to decide which field he has to take up. And really the opportunities are endless, and
Shruti, thank you very much for sharing. I think you made very relevant points. I'm sure it will give a lot of clarity to the students to choose from. So, the question answer rounds are done. We have now the way the entire session worked out, we spoke to the faculty regarding what kind of pedagogy normally we carry in training finance student in the campus. We also spoke to Meet and Shruti, who are working with the corporate, got graduated from the finance domain from SSU. Students, the way we normally train and individuals, and as Dr. Vishal also directly said that, you know, we normally believe in holistic development of the individual. It is not a traditional conventional way of learning which take place here. It was an amazing session today. I really thank to Dr. Sahai, Dr. Vishal Sood, Mr. Meet, and Ms. Shruti Agarwal to be a part of this expert session. Thank you very, very much, everyone.
Thank you, Ravi.
Thank you, Ravi ji.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for bringing me up to the panel here.
Thank you, Shruti. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, sir.
It was nice meeting you all.
Yep. Same here, sir.
Same.